As you all know, he's going to present something on his guitar today, but he's going to use web API, and he's going to show like how powerful web API can be together with his guitar. So now the floor is you. Let's give a warm welcome to him.
Thank you. So welcome to Heapcon, day number 2. I hope you're enjoying the conference so far. What I'll be showing you is a bit different. So I have my guitar here, and I'm going to play, and I'm going to show you how you can build a guitar amplifier using the web audio API. So how did it actually start for me? When I actually bought my first guitar, I bought like the cheapest guitar, and I bought a USB cable. Because I didn't want to buy an actual amplifier, because my reasoning was, if I quit playing guitar in 3 months, I only have to sell my guitar, right? But then, you know, 3 guitars later, 2 amplifiers, 1 FX processor, foot switch, and a lot of bad financial choices, here I am. So even though I'll be... the reason I got into this is because, you know, I was using external software, to like emulate all of the effects, and I thought, hey, if you know, other software can do it, why can't I? So I basically researched about web audio API, because, you know, having things in the browser is cool, and here I am today. So even though I'll be talking about, you know, guitar amplifiers, the techniques that I'll be showing you here can be used for other things. For example, tomorrow if you want to build a voice changer. Maybe you're building a game, you want some cool effects, you know, you want to be able to record audio, do some things like that. With web audio API, you can do all of these things, and hopefully after this talk, you're going to have a pretty good idea on how to accomplish some of these things. So I guess now is the time that I pick up my guitar. All right. It's a bit loud. hopefully it'll be sorted out, okay, or not. But it's fine because I have this volume control here. So I can make it a little bit better. So let me introduce you to one of the most famous songs that I'll probably screw up. So that's it. Wow. All right. Hopefully the rest of the talk will be more technical and less of a concert. All right. So if you've never seen a guitar amplifier, you can see a couple of controls here which can affect the tone. And hopefully through these speakers, I'm pretty sure the people on the live stream would be able to hear it better. But for example, we can control the bass a little bit. So let's, for example, hear it. Yeah, you can definitely hear it. So I can control the middle frequencies, which doesn't sound as good. And what I like is, any Metallica fans? Doesn't sound as Metallica though. So yeah, you have a couple of control knobs for all of the tone. You have a reverb. So actually, if I even do reverb like this, maybe you can hear it because you know this room is a little bit acoustic. But if I do this, you can definitely hear like the reverb effect in here, and I'm probably sure that people on the live stream will hear it much better. I have a volume control. I have an equalizer, which you know, it basically acts like the tone controls, except it can, it has a lot of different frequencies, and it may be something extreme. And I'll reset this so I can show you other things. So for example, I even have some advanced things here. So you can see I can change the reverb impulse, the cabinet impulse. And I'll go over these a little bit later. So for example, when I switch the cabinet to something like this, you should be able to hear a big difference. And I'm going to bypass this. So I'm going to turn off the distortion. So this is pretty much how the guitar sounds without any effects. Okay, I lied. Reverb is active in that case. All right. So I guess in the next 40-ish minutes, I'll take this amplifier, I'll decompose it into multiple submodules, and I'll show you how each of the submodules work, how they're chained together, and how they actually make all of the effects. So the first thing you, when you have a guitar, you know you have to figure out a way to actually connect it to your computer. So what I'm using here is a USB cable that I bought like 5 years ago. This one specific is the Rocksmith USB cable for the game Rocksmith, but there are a couple of other solutions. Something else would be like, for example, an audio interface. And the one on the picture is coincidentally actually sitting right there. So you can plug your guitar into it, then plug the audio interface into your computer and record like that. There are some other options, like for example, I have this Zoom FX processor, which you can also get the clean guitar signal into your computer. So basically, you plug in your you plug your guitar into the FX processor, and you connect the FX processor to your computer. And you can also, like for example, I have a picture of a Katana 50, Boss Katana 50. It's an amplifier which actually also has a USB connection. So once you have that sorted out, you have to figure out, you know, how you can get the guitar input onto the output and add some effects. Now, in this particular case, the effects chain consists of the distortion. Then it's followed by the tone controls. It's followed by the EQ, which is basically like tone controls, just a bit, you know, more granular. Then you have the reverb effect and the cabinet effect. And I'll go over each of those one after another. So I guess the first thing is, how do you actually only play the clean guitar? Well, you have this Navigator Media Devices Get User Media, which you can tell it, hey, I want audio true. And you basically get a stream, which you can then you know, get to the output. Now, it returns a promise because it will actually ask the user for permission. Maybe you've sometimes seen in your browser that it's asking you, hey, do you want to allow audio on this website? So you can handle the error if the user rejects, ask him again, do whatever. What's actually interesting is, for example, if you only say audio true, it doesn't really work well for guitar because browsers sometimes do some, you know, specific things. For example, they do echo cancellation, they do auto gain control because, you know, they're thinking it's a microphone. So if you speak very loudly, it's going to turn down the volume so it doesn't introduce any clipping. If you don't speak loud, if you speak softly, it's going to increase the volume up. And we kind of want to get rid of that, so instead of, you know, saying audio true, you can ask it to do a couple of other things. And then basically it revolves around you creating some web audio nodes and connecting them together in some ways. So for example, we have this simple gain node, which I'll show shortly. You have a bi-quad filter where you can filter out the signal some frequencies. You have a stereo panner, which I'm not using, but for example, you can take the channel and pan it to only the left, take a channel, pan it only to the right, you know, play around with it. And the list has like a lot of these nodes which you can combine together. So the first one is the gain control. And I'm going to play a sample of the clean guitar. So in the example, what I did is I basically created a new gain node. I connected the input to the gain node, connected the gain node to the output, and basically made a chain through the gain node. And the good thing, there are two things you can notice here. The first thing you can notice is that I'm changing the gain control on demand in real time, and it's actually working, so this is cool. The other thing you can notice is that I'm actually not playing my guitar. I have a pre-recorded audio, and I'm actually taking the audio from the audio element and processing it as it's playing. So if you're wondering now, why did I bring a guitar and make a fool of myself, I thought it would be fun. So I guess the distortion effect is really cool. You know, all electric guitars need distortion. And Web Audio provides you with a wave shaper node. And this wave shaper node, you basically set it a curve function, and it does all of the magic for you. So how does the curve function look like? I know. It looks more complex than it is. And on the MDN, they have an actual explanation that you know, sigmoid functions are commonly used for distortion curves, blah, blah, blah. What's really interesting is they tell you, we found the below distortion curve on Stack Overflow, which is nice. But I have a couple of distortion curves that I want to show you right now, and so I can show you how they actually, you know, distort the signal. So if I, for example, select the linear curve, and I play it. This is pretty much the main signal that I recorded from my guitar. You know, linear function does not change the signal in any way. But for example, if I put something like this in it, and I'll have to reduce the volume, and you'll see why in a moment. Prepare your ears. The distorted signal is the more I go to the right. Actually, the curve that I'm using and the settings that I'm using is the same that I'm using in the demo. So why does this actually happen? Sure, you have some other effects in the loop. There's a good explanation. So let's try to analyze this. Web Audio provides us with an analyzer node. We can, you know, configure the analyzer node to, for example, have a fast Fourier transform size of 2048, which is default. The more you increase it, the more delay you basically add, but it's more precise. But 2048 is pretty OK for our case. And when you connect it, when you connect an input signal to it, you'll basically be able to get some time domain data. You can get frequency data, and we can actually draw these things. We can see how the, you know, signal looks like. So again, I'm going to start with the clean sound, and you should be able to see two things. On your left side, you see the waveform. From what I saw yesterday, these TVs have a bit delay. So what I want you to just notice is that the left side is, you know, pretty smooth. It has like sine wave signals. But take a look at the right side, and for example, look at the frequencies. You see where the cutoff is, how many of them are involved, you know? So what I'm going to do now is reduce the volume, for reasons you're about to hear, and enable distortion again. So take a look at it now. And you can clearly see that the left side is isn't smooth anymore. It's not like a sine wave. It's more like a square wave now, because we're distorting it to a point where it behaves like that. And we if we take a look at the right side, notice how the amount of frequencies and as I reduce the gain, you can see. So what happens? So when we distort the signal, we do our job, but we kind of introduce some unnecessary frequencies, because guitars aren't perfect, and when you play a note, you don't actually play only that note. You it also introduces some harmonics and so on and so on, and we can get rid of it. So for example, what we can do is web audio allows us to filter signals. And I have two types of filters. One is pre-filter, so this is pre-distortion, and one is after the distortion. So if I play this, in pre-filter, you can immediately the signal doesn't look as squarey anymore. And what it allows us to do is actually, so a bandpass filter, for example, you set a center frequency to it, and then it kind of passes everything around that frequency to a certain threshold, which is the quality factor, the Q. You have a great explanation on Wikipedia how it works. And we can basically filter out all of the frequencies, because we know that higher frequencies are somewhat harsh and we don't want them as much. And this is basically what we can do. You can hear the sound now. So now it's really muddy. Why? Because I'm able to do a pass filter at 400 Hz, which basically blocks everything after 400 Hz here. It attenuates, which means muddy sound. But if you move it to the right, so you get a much better sound than we did with only the wave shaper. How do you figure these things out? Sure, you can, play around, create these demos, and listen for things. But what's really amazing is if you, for example, Google for the Boss Metal Zone pedal. If you're familiar with, if you're into electric guitar, you know what Boss Metal Zone is, and you can just Google for Boss Metal Zone schematics, and you're actually going to find the entire schematics of the pedal, and people have done certain analysis, so they tell you exactly. There are components which form a high-pass filter with a cutoff at 106 Hz, which means it's a high-pass. Everything after 106 Hz is being passed. The lower frequencies are getting attenuated. So, if you're interested in this, find your favorite pedal or even an amplifier. People have done this with amplifiers, and you can pretty much, do this in the Web Audio API. How are the tone controls done? Pretty easily. Basically, there are filters as well. We have the bass filter, which is low pass, so everything below a certain frequency is going to attenuate or it's going to boost. We have the two middle filter and the presence filter, which are kind of peaking. They are set at certain frequencies, and then they attenuate it or boost it. And then you also have the higher frequencies. And how do you create these filters? Well, you can say context create biquad filter. And then you can configure them with certain frequencies. And then you can also control the gain. And I have an example of that over here. So I have the tone controls. So before, when we had the gain node, when we were setting gain, one meant don't change anything, zero meant nothing is being passed through. And you know, two means double it. For filters, we have controls in decibels. So 10 decibels should be twice as high, or minus 10 decibels is lower it by 2. Next thing we have in the control chain is the in the effects chain is the EQ pedal. And the EQ pedal, basically, there's this boss EQ pedal, which I just took the frequencies and they made filters for it. And it functions basically on the same principle as it does with the tone controls. So we have a couple of frequencies, which are 100, 200, 400, 800. You can see where this is going, up to about 6.4 kilohertz, because usually everything after 7.2 kilohertz is not useful for guitar. And you set the filter to peaking, you can control the gain as you want, and then you connect them in a chain, basically. And it's not hard science. So now we have reverb, and reverb is a bit interesting. How reverb works is there's a convolver node, and you supply it an impulse response, and then you do a convolution, then you also merge these two together. So this one seems a bit complex, but it's actually not. And I have a good example that will show you all of that. So basically, how does it look? Well, we create a convolver. We create the gain for one path, because we have two paths here. We're actually merging the convolve signal with the one from the direct input. And sometimes we may want to play with the volumes a bit. The function set reverb, it looks a bit complicated. It's not. You're going to see how it works. Basically, the more you set the reverb, the more of the convolved signal it passes in. So we need a convolver impulse. What you can do is send an AJAX request, tell it its type of array buffer, and then you just say context decode this signal. And it's going to do everything for you, and then you just set it as a buffer on the convolver. So how does this actually work? OK, I have another example. Impulse response sound like? Usually how these things are created is they set up a microphone in a room and they do a clap or they do something else so they can, you know, capture the resonance of the room. What is convolution, actually? I've been talking about convolver node. Well, if you've been in an engineering, electrical engineering, or if you have to do anything with signals, you probably have encountered this. I know I did at least on three separate courses, and they have never told me that it's actually useful. So if you're interested in convolution, you have a nice page on Wikipedia for that. So now we have the cabinet effect. I've shown you the cabinet effect, but you may be wondering what it is. Well, usually when you have a guitar amplifier, it's an actual physical speaker. OK, maybe you have a guitar amplifier's head, but you're actually plugging it into a speaker. And we have these speakers here. And it's different because, first of all, there's a physical speaker moving. It's vibrating. Then the size of the speaker matters. Then the box itself, you know, you have open cabinets, closed cabinets, which kind of change the sound a bit. They influence it. So how we do cabinet emulation? Simple, like really simple. We do convolution again with cabinet impulse response. The cabinet impulse response is actually it's recorded a bit differently because you know you're not going to clap in a room. What they do is they actually put a microphone in front of a cabinet. They place some frequencies through it, and then they capture it, and then you have the impulse response. And actually, you know, you're obviously not going to record all of these because it requires a lot of gear. So if you're interested in impulse responses, you can just Google for cabinet impulse response or reverb impulse response. These impulse responses basically, you can find them. You can find some for free. You can buy some. They're actually being used a lot because most modeling software supports this. They work on the same. Thing. So if you're actually interested in how it's recorded, there's this video. It's not that long, it's about 7 minutes, where this guy actually shows you all of the gear required and he records an impulse response of his own amplifier. So this is how the amplifier looks. And, but, you know, sure, you might be interested in guitar amplifiers, but this is realistically probably not something you're going to build in your free time. So what else can you do? Well, if you have a video source, you can also process the audio the same way. It's not actually that complex at all. Maybe you want to record audio and play it back or send it to stream it somewhere. For example, I was playing recently with recording voice recordings from a microphone, and I was trying to make them like really low bandwidth, think about 1 to 2 kilobytes per second. And that's actually achievable using the Web Audio API easily. And you can generate sound. So for example, you know, as I said, maybe you're making a video game, you want to generate sound. I've seen some websites which have guitar tablature or you know, they synthesize drums, they do all kinds of things, and you can, you know, do all of these things with the Web Audio API. And there are some other things that you might want to do with the Web Audio API. And there is like a list of big resources that I'll also share with you. So how do you process a video source? Here I have, I got this guitar basically for a weekend to play with it. So I wanted to record myself playing, but what I didn't know is that I did not set up the recording well, so I did not record any effects. I only got the clean guitar in the loop. And I was really sad about it. But you don't have to be sad because you know you can just embed the video on the page and process the add some distortion. How does this work? Well, pretty much the same principle as we had with an audio element on a page. You call a certain method on the context, you select the element, you create a media source from that, and you can use it as pretty much any input. How do you record something? Pretty easily. So you have this media recorder available. All right. So on the media recorder, you have start recording, stop recording, and it actually supports a couple of different options. So for example, you can set bitrate if you want to like generate some lower bitrate sounds. And it actually has callbacks for when it actually records a chunk because it's doing in chunks. And then it tells you, hey, I've stopped, and then you can do whatever you want with it. So in this example, I'm going to try to record something. Not sure what. And what I did is I actually set it on the audio element. And the same rules apply. Now that I have this, I can create a stream source from this and then add some effects to it. Or if you want, you can store it somewhere. This is the hard part. So how do you generate sound? Well, you have a couple of options. Sure, you can use the Web Audio API directly, but I really like this Tone.js library. It has like a good API, and it actually has a lot of examples on their website. And all of these examples are pretty much interactive as well, so take a listen. I see someone enjoying. As I said, they're interactive. Interested in generating sound or even like not creating your own effects, there are tons of libraries that have this pretty much built in, so you can just create a new effect and then configure it the way you like. If you're interested in other web audio resources, I invite you to take a look at this GitHub project. It has a lot of different effects libraries or visualizations. I'll give you a moment to take a picture if you'd like. Also, there's a shorter URL. If you're interested in other guitar amplifiers, you have this. You have two of them. The second one, JS Rocks, it has been done quite recently, and I also found it as a great inspiration. And the Web Audio Guitar Amplifier Simulator 3. Is actually, there's a thesis on it. Someone has actually, you know, they took a schematic of the JCM amplifier. They, you know, implemented the kind of the same things in web audio, and it's really high quality, although the code isn't as readable, unfortunately. So that would be it for me. Thank you. Now, as far as the code, you have it on my GitHub account. The slides are a bit problematic because you know, this is like an interactive presentation and it's a mashup of everything. So maybe I'll release this. Follow me on Twitter, and I'll see what I can do. After this talk, I'm going to go to the Heapspace booth and I'm going to be playing the guitar. So if you want to play around with it, maybe you want to you know, check it out. So I'll be playing for the next half an hour or an hour. And if you notice there are two donation boxes for children battling cancer. So please donate, and I'll be matching all of your donations, or until I go bankrupt, hopefully. But think about the children, not about my wallet. Where's my wallet? I'm sorry. Thank you.